powers to be a credible and military capabilities to be a credible player at the world stage. This EU having a bigger role in the world and being a more credible world actor with a very strong idea and message of the European Commission at the moment. And of course it's not only about creating better defense capabilities. A big problem for the EU in the foreign policy field is unanimity rule. Basically everything that you have to decide at the EU level on foreign policy issues, on security issues, it's done on a unanimity principle. And this is of course something that has hindered developments so far a lot. And it's something that that keeps to make you weaker, because even though citizens very much like especially stronger EU action in the field of foreign policy and security policy, and it's somehow that those diplomats of the member states who are very eager to agree about closer cooperation in many other fields, they are not so easy to agree on closer cooperation and moving from unanimity to qualified majority voting in their own field of activity. So this idea of having a stronger EU role in the world is definitely not directed against NATO or the United States, as it's already very clearly stipulated in EU treaties as well. EU action in this defense field can be only complementary to NATO, so it's a complementary action. And what I want to stress as my last point on EU-NATO relations, it's indeed a normal cooperation which can very easily be strengthened now between two institutions, because there is a clear need, and of course the threats have moved into the area where with hybrid wars, where the EU has more competences, because there is any longer not so clear divide between exactly military defense and wider defense issues. And I would simply want to end with one concrete example of how this cooperation that EU member states are deepening between themselves in the field of defense is also very beneficial and complementary to NATO. It's within PESCO. Hannes Hans already mentioned this thing. It's easier movement of military within the EU. It's so-called military Schengen. Schengen is a success project of the European Union, so its name is also used often in this defense cooperation. I would imagine that when you think about movement of military technique in the EU borders and facilitating this movement, so it's of course NATO that would greatly benefit from it mostly, because most of military operations are still done by NATO. So I see no problem in having this complementary action and deepening the cooperation between two organizations.
Thank you. Instead of me asking you what practices of communication in theory in both NATO and the EU, I thought I'd get a chance to develop it in practice. So perhaps we take some questions from the audience.
Can I say one thing?
Please, quickly, yes. But first, start preparing your
question. Yeah. I just wanted to say, because you mentioned military Schengen, of course, we prefer to talk about military mobility. firstly, Schengen is an EU term, and not all NATO allies are a member of the Schengen thing. And secondly, it's more than just border controls or make it easier to cross borders, which Schengen is mainly about. It's also about preparing infrastructure, particularly roads and bridges, to carry heavy military equipment. So it's